sa meca. The eyes of the world are focused here on St. Peter's Square today for an event the likes of which we have never seen. Two popes will be recognized as saints today, and as if that weren't enough, two living popes will celebrate this historic canonization mass. I'm Raymond Arroyo, and we are delighted to bring you this live EWTN News coverage of the mass and canonizations of Pope John Paul II and John the 23rd. We feel so privileged to be here for this great historic event and to bring it to you live. This is, incidentally, the first double canonization of popes since the Middle Ages. To acquaint us with the two saints to be, I am delighted to welcome to the set our canonization crew. First, Robert Royal, the editor of thecatholicthing.org, and Father Gerald Murray of the Archdiocese of New York. And if you'd like to comment, thank you, gentlemen, for being with us, and we're looking forward to a fantastic, beautiful event. And the day couldn't be better, because I love an overcast day. If you'd like to comment on the coverage, or if you have a question, send us a tweet at Raymond Arroyo. There are 90 international delegations in that square behind us, 24 heads of state and royalty, over 150 cardinals, and 1,000 bishops in attendance. Gentlemen, on this Divine Mercy Sunday, why and what is the most important thing we need to know about these two popes, respectively? Father Murray, I'll start with you.
Right. Pope John the 23rd sort of brought the church into the post-World War II era with a renewed confidence. And that confidence led him to summon the Second Vatican Council and to bring the church into the modern world without, in fact, changing the church, but renewing and reinforcing. And today we honor that heritage and we say, thank you, Lord, for this very holy man.
Robert Royal.
Well, I think both of these popes not only brought the church into the modern world, but they really decided that the church was going to engage and triumph over those elements in the modern world that needed to hear the gospel. So this was an expression of confidence on both of their parts that they would step out into the public square in a way that hadn't really happened earlier. They used modern media. They, of course, with John Paul II, he visited many, many different parts of the world. So this is a day, I think, to celebrate the way that the Catholic Church now has a presence. And it's recognized, even with this Pope Francis, that when the Pope speaks about things that are current in our world, mm-hmm. it matters in a way that almost no religious figure
does. Robert, I'm going to stop you for 1 second. Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI is now entering. You saw him there for a moment. He was vested. This is the first time he has joined Pope Francis in vestments. They had one event that he attended in the Basilica. He's concelebrating today. There he is, embracing. I'm not certain. Is that Cardinal Etchecaray? I'm not sure.
Hard to see, but this is historic to have a retired pope celebrating with the reigning pope.
And the bells of St. Peter's pealing away behind us, and you'll forgive if we don't overwhelm them. They're pretty hard to overwhelm and compete with. I want to talk for a moment. We'll start with John Paul II as we set the stage and introduce people to this momentous event you're about to witness, and it is an exciting moment. You could feel it here in Rome in these days, but particularly yesterday. We were having lunch, and at some point I heard a man yell out, Juan Pablo, Juan Pablo. And here came a little boy. Everywhere you turn, there's some child named after John Paul. Half of Poland has invaded Italy, it seems. I think this is called payback. It's an amazing thing that's happening here. Tell me about the allure of John Paul II and the grip he seems to have on several generations of Catholics who have come out in force.
Absolutely. It's history does, in fact, teach us that great men can shape their era. And I think John Paul II falls into that category. In fact, it's probably at the top of the category. The formation, though, is not on the level of celebrity. It's on the level of where does he lead people? Where does he take them? John Paul II understood the deepest desires in the heart of man, and he pointed them right to Christ. In addition, he said the Blessed Virgin Mary, who was the source of his inspiration to become a priest and serve the Lord, she is always with us. That Marian devotion is a large reason why people love John Paul II.
Robert Royal.
Well, as the father of a young man named John Paul.
I figured there'd be one in the bunch.
I can speak directly from personal experience. You know, it's one of the remarkable things. My son is 30 years old now, but it's one of the remarkable things that people of that generation, up until quite recently, of course, only knew one pope.
Right.
And he
exactly.
was so long in the papacy, he was so powerful, he was so present everywhere, that it entirely reshaped the kind of an understanding. And they miss him, I miss him. We've got great popes since then too, but it's an extraordinary thing that this one human being could dominate the church and the world for such a long time.
We should tell people, there are churches now watching us live in Chicago, in Detroit, particularly the Polish community, who their hearts, I know, are filled. I bumped into Cardinal Stanislaw Ziewicz, the Pope's personal secretary, just here out on our balcony. And when he came up, I hadn't seen him in maybe 4 years since we did an interview with him in Washington. And he walked up, and I said, "Your Eminence," and he put his arms out and grabbed mine, and he said, "I know you," and I said, "You do," and so we exchanged, and tears started welling up in my eyes and his. That spirit of John Paul, you can touch it, you can feel it, and it is so alive here in these days. I want to roll this for you. This is our dear friend, Father Richard John Newhouse, my former co-host of Happy Memory. Here is his insight on Pope John Paul, and then I want you two gents to elaborate on this. Here's Father Richard John Newhouse.
He believed right from the beginning that culture is stronger than politics, mm-hmm. stronger than the military factor, stronger than the economic factor. And by culture, what does one mean? One means the ideas by which people live, by which they understand themselves and the world of which they're part. And particularly those ideas that are most foundational to their deepest convictions, which are usually religious in character. For example, very beautifully under Nazism when he was a young man. John Paul studied theology, he wrote poems, he acted in theater illegally,
right.
At the risk of his life and the life of others. And some people would say, well, you know, what effect is that? That's an ineffectual, idealistic, kind of dreamy approach. Mm-hmm. And John Paul then intuited and later would explain the intuition with great persuasiveness that no, the cultural positing of the possibility of human dignity and freedom is power. It is power. Mm. It effects change.
There is nobody like Father Richard for sort of summarizing where we are. I want to talk about that creativity he talked about, that ingenuity that John Paul had. We forget now because we take these things for granted. World Youth Days were something no pope had ever done before the man from Wadowice occupied this see. Tell me about those World Youth Days, how the impact of them, your thoughts of them.
I went to two of them. I went to the one in Poland and also in Denver. What was striking to the world outside was, why are all these young people going to hear this man from Rome? In fact, World Youth Day demonstrated a truth that is eternal. Young people want to give themselves to something greater than their own entertainment and desire. They want to give themselves to something that is lasting. Pope John Paul II came up and represented Christ in a way that was attractive, but it was also challenging. And it was great to see the reaction. So many people joined the seminary, became sisters, Catholic marriages came out of it. It's wonderful.
Well, no, I bumped into an OBGYN, a pro-life OBGYN from Lafayette, Louisiana last night, and he was saying, you know, I really owe my vocation to John Paul, and it didn't lead me to the priesthood, but it led me to this life and how rich it is, and it wouldn't be this way if it weren't for him.
I mean, of course, young people were, the church was inviting young people in to participate prior to the inauguration of World Youth Days. But to put that sort of on the calendar, to make that a public mark of what the church does on a regular basis, is one of those expressions, as you rightly say, the genius of John Paul. And there were others. I mean, we reached the millennium in 2000, and he made a special point of trying to touch various points at that moment. One of my own books, my book on the 20th century Catholic martyrs, was written specifically, and I gave him a copy of it on May 7, 2000, because it was a commemoration of something that he wanted to look back at and make a special reference towards at that key moment in a transition between the millennia. So he was constantly thinking and putting out these sort of new dynamic ideas.
I want to give people a little taste of John Paul. Part of what made him so attractive, I think, particularly to young people, was the clarity of his call. It was so countercultural, what he was saying. This is John Paul from Denver in 1993. He is at a welcoming ceremony, and it gives you an insight that into a part of his papacy, and I think it covered the entire papacy. Take a look.
The ultimate test of your greatness is the way you treat every human being, but especially the weakest and most defenseless ones. The best traditions of your land presume respect for those who cannot defend themselves. If you want equal justice for all and true freedom and lasting peace, then America, defend life. All the great causes that are yours today will have meaning only to the extent that you guarantee the right to life and protect the human person.
You hear the enthusiasm and the excitement there. We're getting tweets from folks at St. Louis University. They're having viewing parties in the middle of the night to be a part of this live. We thank you all for joining us. For some insight on the crowd that is gathered behind us for this historic occasion, we're joined by EWTN News Nightly's Brian Patrick. Brian, thanks for being here.
Well, it's great to be joining you.
What are you seeing out there in the streets?
Well, it looks like the whole world has come here to Rome. People have converged here from all over the place to celebrate this moment of history, a moment I know I'll never forget. As the crowds grew last night, though, it became more and more difficult to get around. Now, some of us were fortunate to find some of the prayer vigils, the all-night vigils at the beautiful churches of Rome. This was a powerful reminder that this is really a prayerful celebration. It feels like a carnival at some times, but it is prayerful. Both of the popes being canonized today were world leaders who changed the world and endeared themselves to the people of the world, but they are saints because of their holiness. And their prayer lives are an example to all of us that we're called to be saints, and it's only in prayer that we get there. Speaking of getting there, it is almost impossible to get anywhere out there this morning. EWTN News Nightly's Alan Holdren and our photographer Paul Fifield are out in the thick of the crowds. Alan?
So down here just outside St. Peter's Square, surrounded by pilgrims from all over the world. There are people with flags, mostly from Poland. A lot of people who spent all night here, Mexicans, Irish, Americans, Belgians. We got people from everywhere, and they're all here for this canonization celebration that's going to be starting here in a little bit, but already last night, the excitement was palpable.
Rome's streets last night, overrun with pilgrims for the canonization.
I'm looking forward to just the energy that the people that are all here from lots of different countries bring to celebrate the legacy of two very special people in this world.
They've come from every corner of the globe.
The people are very happy. All the people are singing in peace. This is very important in this world at this moment.
All in celebration.
This evening I will go in some church. I would like to go in Santa Maria Maggiore because usually the Pope Francis go there. So it's important, it's nice.
Both the popes are actually people of, they did a lot of things to the church. And also I think they made an impression on the people, especially Pope John, Paul II. He was very good with the young people. So I think, and especially the Polish crowd, you know, they like to see their One of their men is canonized.
They're calm despite the rain, ready for a night of prayer in Rome, to be one of the fortunate few who make it into the square, driven by a common purpose, to be in the presence of the saints.
So you can see there, these people from all over the place are really excited about this celebration. It's about to get started. This is going to be one of the biggest celebrations here in Rome this year. Back up to you in the studio.
Thank you, Alan. And Brian, thank you for being here. You see that crowd packed in, you that shot down the Via Conciliazione, a million strong to see this event. And I wish they were as quiet and prayerful as they were in that package outside my hotel last night. I don't know where you were, but they were banging, singing, Juan Pablo II. This went on at 1 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 3 o'clock, 4 o'clock, and by the time I came down at 5:30, they were still chanting and singing.
It was so, like a party.
It is a party, and there's parties going on all over the United States, Scotland, Ireland, many people, colleges are having viewing parties, so we're delighted you're here, and Brian, thank you for all you've done and are doing.
Grateful.
News Nightly will be doing a complete wrap of these events on their Monday night show. Be sure to tune in for that. And I now want to turn to John the 23rd, this other pope who's being raised to the altars this week, or this day, in fact. Tell me the importance of John the 23rd. Certainly he initiated the Vatican Council, the Second Vatican Council, and it was something, an inspiration, something placed on his heart.
Well, he succeeded Pope Pius XII, who for the last number of years of his pontificate had not been well, and the church, basically starting anew, he had the inspiration that we have to engage the modern world, as Bob said, and bring the truths of the faith into a way that people will understand. He wanted to continue the work of the First Vatican Council to address the issues that remain unaddressed. But he was a man who also wanted to bring the joy of the love of the Lord to people. He wasn't, as we said the other day, a revolutionary, wanted to upset things in the church. Yeah. He wrote an encyclical on the value of Latin.
That was his Latin, right?
Absolutely.
Apostolic Constitution at the end of his life.
He had a pontificate less than 4 years, so many things he wanted to do couldn't be accomplished. But he certainly gave the example of holiness as a young priest and bishop. This was a man devoted to the Lord.
Robert, let's talk about his sanctity. When you read the autobiography, it's clear this is a man struggling for holiness from his earliest years when he started that journal. And you see it right up through the pontificate. Talk a bit about that sanctity.
One of the ironies about John the 23rd is he's such a pastoral, personal man. And he never served as a parish priest. He never served in a parish, and so this sort of pastoral impulse had to survive while he was a papal delegate in Turkey, Bulgaria, and Greece, and then in France, where he, you know, when you get appointed as a nuncio in France, it must mean that they have some great confidence in you here in Europe, because France, for whether truthfully or not, is usually considered sort of a cultural center. But he had that impulse everywhere that he went, and it stayed with him. And when he became pope, I think that the thing that many people misunderstood about him was that, again, as Father says, he was not a revolutionary. What he thought was that what the truth and the joy of what the church had was so important and was so good that the world was missing out on something that he was hoping to bring to it. That was the revolutionary part.
Yeah, and the buoyancy and the joy he brought to the office, the good Pope John, people were, I think, captivated by his warm smile, his willingness to break the protocols of the day and go off to the Bambino Gesù clinic over here or meet with prisoners or simply go out in priest garb and walk through the streets handing out little scrolls. A friend told me who was here at the time, he would hand out little scrolls and bless the children, and he'd ask them, what do you think of the Pope? And they'd tell him, and he said, don't open that till you get home. And of course, when they got home, it was a note from Pope John the 23rd, and they were, oh, that was him. And they had missed the opportunity to really engage him, but it was an interesting way of getting reconnaissance and being with the people.
He was a paisan, and not only a paisan, but his family was a farming family up in northern Italy, up near Bergamo. In fact, he tells a joke in one of his essays about how there are three ways to go to ruin: gambling, drink, and farming. And he said, my father chose the most boring of the three of those.
Well, the whole world is watching tonight, and you just mentioned the paisans. They are crowding in with the Polish folks here, and it's a real competition.
Right.
I think Poland is sort of winning at this point from the banners, at least, that you see up and down the square. There, of course, John Paul II, John Paul the Great. Such a beautiful day, and I am struck by the silence. You can hear a pin drop now in this square. You can't hear a thing. Just the organ.
Well,
and the Mass is about to begin, and there is a solemnity that has taken root here. In about 10 minutes, we'll bring you that live.
The crowd gathered has seen Pope Benedict Emeritus, who is now in the square, vested for Mass, and I think that's a profound moment of joy for so many of us.
What is the impact of that? Having two popes here, it is something peculiar in the history of the Church and rare. The impact of that?
Well, Pope Benedict was a man of courage throughout his whole life, and he served under this saint-to-be, John Paul II, faithfully as a servant for so many years, and now he's rendering homage to God for the goodness of the Lord sending us Pope John Paul II. Yeah. And he's doing so himself, having made that act of courage. He said he didn't feel up to continuing as Pope, and he wanted to serve the Church by praying and studying for her, and that's what he's doing.
I really see this, and Robert, I want your take on this, not as a way to balance those on the right or the left within the Catholic Church and bring people together. I see this as a cry for continuity, continuity in sanctity. And you have John the 23rd, John Paul II, Benedict the 16th, and Francis all together around this one event. Is there something there, do you think?
You know, it's a strange combination of charisma that all these four men have, yeah, in a strange way, and also humility. We talk a lot about the humility of Francis, but one of the things about Benedict, another man who I think is much misunderstood outside of certain circles in Catholicism, one of the things about him is that everywhere he went, the reputation, of course, in the secular media was that he was God's Rottweiler and he was the enforcer for John Paul II in the Vatican. But he won people over. When he went to England, this sort of humble, scholarly demeanor, he's everybody's grandfather, and he won them over. When he came to the United States, I was very worried. I live in Washington, as you do, and I was very worried how the media was going to react to him. And they just warmed to him. They just realized that he's this embodiment of Catholicism at its best, where there's a personal side to it, and also a firmness that you come to respect.
Absolutely. In fact, that's one of the key things we have to remember here. Pope John Paul II helped rescue the Church from the uncertainties after the Council. Mm-hmm. The Catechism of the Catholic Church, the great encyclicals, wherever he went to speak, he would touch on those issues, the life issue we heard about in Denver. The Pope confronts the world and its evils in order to turn it to Christ and bring it joy. Benedict did that. Francis is doing that now. John the 23rd did the same thing.
In the history of pontiffs, we have really been blessed by the array of men, holy, solid men, willing to engage the world in new and creative ways for really the last century. It's been an incredible run.
I mean, we've had 100, 125 years of really great popes. Mm-hmm. And I would say the modern papacy really, in my view, begins with Leo XIII, his teachings about Catholic social doctrine, his renewal of Thomist philosophy. Mm-hmm. And in one after another, God seems to bring them out in exactly the right moment. Benedict the 15th. Was an important figure in trying to prevent World War I. The ways that Pius XI and XII confronted Nazism, how communism was confronted by all of them. It's a series of great accomplished men who were also holy, but were out there in the world doing something that figures within the world couldn't do.
There is something I want to work in before we take you to the Mass, and that is only moments away, so stay tuned. I promise the pre-show won't last forever. John Paul took us into this third millennium, and he was focused on a new evangelization. He was really the father of this new evangelization. Talk a bit about that. I'm remembering those images of him opening the holy door.
Right.
And I have to tell you, and I'm sure for you all as well, to me it feels like this is a family reunion. You're going to tribute Granddad. And, you know, and having sat here for so many of these events, his travels, that holy door, I tell you, I'm a little on the edge of weeping through a lot of this, but talk to me about that new evangelization.
Yeah, the new evangelization, this is something that maybe as Americans we don't appreciate so much. There's a world weariness in Europe, which in particular in Western Europe, that the Pope said, this is not going to last. We're going to revive the faith of Christ, which formed Europe and made it what it is today, and we're going to bring it back to its original purity and love. The Nazi and communist movements represented frontal threats to Catholic teaching and Catholic life. Secularism, Pope John Paul II recognized, and this kind of spirit of no religion at all in the public square, he confronted that in places like France, Spain, Italy, here, England. And, you know, United States of America, we are in a big battle now between the forces of secularism and those that want to defend the things that God has given to us.
You know, as I said the other night, just reflecting on John Paul's journey with us began in 1978, the entire church, when he became Pope. Mother Angelica started EWTN in its infancy. She began to make the noises in 1978, didn't start it till 81. I see those tracks so clearly now. Mother, I think, was so much a part of that new evangelization, and the Mass is beginning, so I guess that's a good transition. This is our live coverage from St. Peter's Square of this Mass of Divine Mercy and the canonizations of John Paul II and John the 23rd, celebrated by Pope Francis, and in attendance is Pope Emeritus Benedict the 16th. It is quite an historic day. We will leave you to some of the sounds and we'll be dipping in throughout. Thank you for joining us. This is EWTN News live continuing coverage of this historic moment.
canonized on the same day.
No, and again, we have not seen this since the Middle Ages. It just doesn't happen. And this is the first pope, I believe, in, what, 50 years?
Yes, that's right. We didn't see Benedict walking. At least I didn't see him on the monitor. So he's had trouble walking. We may find that he's actually seated somewhere.
Pope Benedict. They brought him out earlier, and he's seated with the cardinals on the side, but he's fully vested. Mm-hmm. So he'll be concelebrating.
Yes, which is the first time, I think, since he resigned as pope that he will have concelebrated
Correct.
Public mass.
There was the mass earlier this year in the Basilica that he attended, but he did not concelebrate.
Various cardinals greeting Pope Emeritus Benedict.
No, I don't think that's Pope Benedict there.
Yes, he was hidden behind the pole.
Oh.
Meanwhile, we're hearing the Litany of the Saints that these two popes are about to join.
Incidentally, only two popes have become saints in the last several decades here.
Centuries.
Centuries,
yes.
Yeah.
Pope Pius X.
Pius X and Pius V.
Pius V, yes, absolutely.
Since that was 1712.
Yes, yes.
I thought decades. We're talking centuries.
Well, this reminds me of what Bob said earlier. We have been blessed with extraordinarily good popes for the last 150 years.
And now there is the rumor, and again, it's a rumor, that we may soon hear about the beatification of Paul VI.
That's allegedly, it's a rumor out there. That's the true thing. And, well, God's goodness is manifest in many ways. And Pope Paul VI, a great churchman, suffered much for the church as he tried to make Vatican II not simply a moment of discontinuity, as many people claim, but in fact, the fulfillment of the church's mission. He struggled greatly for that. Humanae Vitae was one of the most bitter experiences of his life when he proclaimed the truth. He was rejected by many, even including churchmen.
Mm-hmm. And it's interesting that Francis, who's usually portrayed it as trying to change church teaching by secularists, has called Pope Paul VI heroic and prophetic in his stand Catholic doctrine.
If you read Humanae Vitae, you're inspired. The Pope saw what was coming.
Pope Francis now incensing the altar, and we are going to hand you over for a time to Vatican Radio translation of this historic moment, this historic Mass in St. Peter's Square, the canonization Mass on this Divine Mercy Sunday for Pope John Paul II and John the 23rd. And Mass has begun.
John and John Paul are enrolled in the Book of the Saints.
And this sets the tone for the whole celebration, which is right. Why it takes place at the very beginning.
And we'll hear for the first time then in the Eucharistic prayer the names of these two new saints who are offered for universal veneration throughout the world.
Francis is wearing simple white vestments for this canonization Mass. We remind you that you are tuned to Vatican Radio. We're broadcasting to you live from St. Peter's Square. Today, the second Sunday of Easter and Divine Mercy Sunday. This, I think we call this an iconic moment, do we not, Father Tom?
Here we see once again, we've seen this a couple times in the past, when he visited Castel Gandolfo last year, and then the blessing of a fountain or a plaque in the Vatican Gardens, and once again before the eyes of the world. The present Pope embracing Pope Emeritus, two brothers, and I would dare say two friends. getting the beautiful statue of the Blessed Mother, which has been placed here today.
The same statue that we see to the left of the main altar of St. Peter's during important celebrations, Christmas and Easter. The Holy Father now makes his way to the chair from which he will begin the celebration.
In nomine Patris et Filii et Spiritus Sancti.
Amen.
Pax vobis.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
And this is the point where we begin the canonization ceremony, as you said, Cardinal Angelo Amato, Prefect of the Congregation of the Causes of Saints. Certainly.
Most Holy Father,
instanter postulat Sancta Mater Ecclesia.
Holy Mother Church earnestly beseeches your holiness
catalogo sanctorum
to enroll blessed
et tanquam ab omnibus Christi fidelibus pronunciari beatos
blessed John the 23rd and John Paul the 2nd among the saints, that they may be invoked as such by all the Christian faithful. Dear brothers, let us lift up our prayers to God the Father Almighty through Jesus Christ, that through the intercession of the Blessed Virgin Mary and all the saints, he may sustain with his grace the act which we now solemnly undertake.
We're asked to observe a moment's silence now and to contemplate, to reflect on what we've just heard.
We ask you, Lord, graciously to accept the prayers of your people, that our devoted service may be pleasing to you and contribute to the growth of your church through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the second petition follows immediately.
Most Holy Father, strengthened by unanimous prayer, Holy Church more earnestly beseeches your holiness to enroll these, her children, among the saints. Let us then invoke the Holy Spirit, the giver of life, that he may enlighten our minds, and that Christ our Lord may not permit his church to err in a matter of such importance.
And in fact, we take those words literally, invoking the Holy Spirit through the beautiful hymn, Veni Creator Spiritus.
There was a question from one of our viewers, why the banners, if you will, the images, are unveiled already. Shouldn't there be an unveiling? And that unveiling takes place at the beatifications. And since they're already known to the world, the sanctity now today proclaimed during the canonization is not a secret. The world sees this beautifully and in these wonderful images, radiant images of these two soon to be proclaimed saints of the Catholic Church.
Some of the dignitaries, heads of state in attendance.
These are some of the dignitaries, heads of state in attendance.
Here present, 24 royals or heads of states, state prime ministers, and Pope Benedict or Pope Francis. Now it's hard for me to stop saying that. Pope Francis about to begin this mass.
Beatissime Pater, Sancta Ecclesia. Domini promisso nixa spiritum veritatis in semitendi, qui omni tempore supremum magisterium erroris expertem reddit,
from error,
instantissime supplicat sanctitatem
most earnestly beseeches your holiness to enroll these, her elect,
in sanctorum catalogum
among the saints. Referat.
Now the solemn moment in which the Holy Father pronounces the formula of canonization.
For the honor of the Blessed Trinity, the exaltation of the Catholic faith, and the increase of the Christian life by the authority of our Lord Jesus Christ and of the holy apostles Peter and Paul and our own, after due deliberation and frequent prayer for divine assistance, and having sought the counsel of many of our brother bishops, we declare and define Blessed John the 23rd and John Paul the 2nd be saints, and we enroll them among the saints, decreeing that they are to be venerated as such by the whole Church.
In
the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
And with that simple and profound declaration, Saint John Paul II and Saint John the 23rd are official. Beautiful moment, and this crowd burst into applause, and you can hear it all the way down the Via Conciliazione here.
It's the joy of the Holy Spirit manifesting his action in the life of the Church, and for the glory of God and exaltation of the Catholic faith, we now can call upon these two saints to intercede for us and protect us.
And it's remarkable in this canonization formula that we mention Saints Peter and Paul. We go all the way back to that very beginning of the Church here in Rome. This spot, St. Peter's, is we think historically is the place where St. Peter was actually crucified himself upside down. There are the bones of Peter that we think have been discovered under the main altar in St. Peter's itself. So this is a moment that really unites the whole history of the Catholic Church.
And there they are, John the 23rd, and you saw John Paul the Great just before him.
Think of
now,
John.
Now, these are the relics that are being brought forward, I believe. There's a candle there, but I believe there's a procession of the relics that is to take place. You see Pope Benedict there on your screen, singing along with the crowd here.
And the relics will be incensed by a deacon, a sign of respect and devotion, veneration, and reminding us that the prayer ascends to heaven like incense, and now the prayer of these saints, prayers to these saints, rather, will be a source of great solace and strength to the Church.
Yes, this is the procession of the relics, and they're going to be brought forward to the altar. John Paul II's relics, this is his blood. Which was also used during the 2011 beatification ceremony. John the 23rd, there's a bit of his skin taken when his body was exhumed for his 2000 beatification. So that those are the two relics that are now making their way forward. And the relic, talk for a moment about relics for those who might be outside of the church. This is really a touchstone of faith, and they're venerated as
such. Christianity is an incarnational religion. Christ became man and sanctified all of humanity as a result. The baptized who receive the grace of regeneration, their bodies are made holy by the presence of the Holy Spirit. So the mortal remains are holy, and we venerate them. And now the Pope will kiss the reliquary, a sign of devotion. There's nothing macabre about relics. Relics are, in fact, a sign of confidence that what Christ said, that when he returns at the end of the ages, the bodies of all the saints will be reunited with their souls, and they will go live forever in the New Jerusalem, in heaven forever. The worship of God is not compromised by the veneration of relics. Relics remind us of God's action of holiness in the lives of the faithful.
We remember from the early days of Christianity that one of the things the church wanted to affirm was that Christ indeed was God present in the flesh here in our world. That we are not simply a philosophy, or we're just not a spirituality. We are a faith that takes very seriously that God created this world, and it is a good world, and that the physical things here properly used are part of what God's intention was in creation.
And the church's belief, the teaching is, these individuals are in heaven with God. They're our intercessors, yes. And they're part of the communion of saints. So what they leave behind, the clothes they wore, their bones, these are venerated because they're touchstones of those people and witnesses that they really existed, they were really here, and I might someday be able to achieve the same level of sanctity that they did.
Indeed. Professor at the seminary taught us the body is not like the envelope you throw away when you read the letter. The body, in fact, will be resurrected.
You sound like Father Richard Newhouse, whom when we saw John Paul's body laid out in St. Peter's Basilica and all the people were streaming by, I said, oh, he looks so small, he's not there. And he said, oh, no, he is there, Raymond, he is there. This is what carried the grape soul for so many years. And, of course, he was right, as he always was. The relic's now solemnly being processed to the altar. And then there will be a prayer, the first prayers offered to these two newly minted saints, John the 23rd and John Paul the 2nd. And it will be the very first time that the church corporately invokes their intercession. The relic of John Paul with his blood there is put in a place of honor off to the side of the altar. And now the relics of John the 23rd.
It's interesting, with relics of saints are always put in front of the altar, on the altar at a canonization. But right now we have relics of two saints who celebrated Mass on the very spot where their relics are being kept.
That is awesome.
This is something to rejoice in.
It really is a day of four popes.
It is indeed.
And an awesome moment to be here in Rome, and we are delighted to bring this to you live. This is EWTN's live complete coverage of this canonization mass from St. Peter's Square. Pope Francis presiding. You see the two relics of the two men on those beautiful banners that have been gracing the front of St. Peter's for a few days.
Think of this, Raymond, also. Pope John Paul II shed his blood on the very site now where that blood is being venerated as a saint. The blood of Christ, the blood of the martyrs, the blood of Pope John, now St. John Paul II.
During the assassination attempt in 81.
81, right in this very square. Mm.
These Bernini colonnade, that Bernini colonnade has seen such history unfold. And this, a monumental day, particularly for those of us who knew John Paul II and covered him and his papacy.
Also the square in which I think we have to say he perhaps gave the most heroic witness in the way he died. I interviewed a young Swiss guard who was working in St. Peter's Square as 80,000 people were here keeping villages, vigil as the Pope was dying. And he said to me, you know, I've handled hundreds of large crowds in St. Peter's Square, but I had never seen so many people standing quietly while an event was occurring. He said it was a moment I will never forget.
No, it was extraordinary. He showed us how to live, and he taught us how to die through his example in both cases. This vibrant, young Pope in his late 50s when this journey started, and then to watch him, really, he became an oblation to the church in many ways.
He almost died as a young man even before he entered the clandestine seminary. He was hit by a truck coming back from the chemical factory. God preserved his life, and he gave that life completely to the Lord.
Pope Francis contemplating all of this as they incense the relics of these two new saints. And the Polish pride is in abundance today. You see all those Polish flags and banners throughout this square and all the way down to the Tiber. This is EWTN's live continuing coverage of this canonization mass.
Beatissime Pater, Nomine Sancte Ecclesiae, enixas gratia sago, de pronunciatione a sanctitate vestra facta, acumili perpetuo.
Most Holy Father, in the name of the Holy Church, I thank Your Holiness for making this proclamation and humbly request that You decree that the apostolic letter concerning the act of canonization be drawn up.
That's the voice again of Cardinal Angelo Amato, prefect of the Congregation for the Causes of Saints, literally thanking the Holy Father for pronouncing that canonization formula. The two embrace. And the Gloria will be following very shortly.
Oremus.
Let us pray.
Deus misericordia sempiterna.
God of everlasting mercy, who in the very recurrence of the Paschal feast kindle the faith of the people you have made your own, increase, we pray, the grace you have bestowed, that all may grasp and rightly understand in what font they have been washed, by whose spirit they have been reborn, by whose blood they have been redeemed. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen.
As you've heard, this Mass is being celebrated in Latin, the universal language of the Catholic Church. The readings, however, will be in Italian in honor of St. John the 23rd and in Polish in honor of St. John Paul II. The Gospel will be sung both in Latin and in Greek. The first reading is from the Acts of the Apostles. It's chapter 2, verse 42.
Dagli Atti degli Apostoli. Quelli che erano stati battezzati erano perseveranti nell'insegnamento degli Apostoli.
The whole community remained faithful to the teaching of the Apostles, to the brotherhood, to the breaking of bread, and to the prayers.
Un senso di timore era in tutti.
The many miracles and signs worked through the Apostles made a deep impression on everyone.
Tutti i credenti stavano insieme.
The faithful all lived together and owned everything in common.
Vendevano le loro proprietà e sostanze.
They sold their goods and possessions and shared out the proceeds among themselves according to what each one needed.
Ogni giorno erano perseveranti insieme nel tempio.
They went as a body to the temple every day and met in their houses for the breaking of bread.
Con letizia e semplicità di cuore, lodando Dio.
They shared their food gladly and generously. They praised God and were looked up to by everyone. Day by day, the Lord added to their community those destined to be saved.
Quelli che erano salvati.
Verbum Domini.
The psalm response will be Psalm 117, the refrain, Alleluia, 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 the Easter hymn, and then of course the singing of Psalm 117.
Grida di giubilo e di vittoria nelle terre.
destra del Signore ha fatto prodezze.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
La pietra scartata dai costruttori è divenuta la pietra d'angolo. Questo è stato fatto dal Signore, una meraviglia ai nostri occhi. Questo è il giorno che ha fatto il Signore, rallegriamoci in esso ed esultiamo.
And now the second reading will be taken from the first letter of St. Peter.
Blessed
be God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in his great mercy has given us a new birth as his sons by raising Jesus Christ from the dead, so that we have a sure hope and the promise of an inheritance that can never be spoilt or soiled and never fade away, because it is being kept for you in the heavens. Through your faith, God's power will guard you until the salvation which has been prepared is revealed at the end of time. This is a cause of great joy for you, even though you may for a short time have to bear being plagued by all sorts of trials, so that when Jesus Christ is revealed, your faith will have been tested and proved like gold. Only it is more precious than gold, which is corruptible even though it bears testing by fire. And then you will have praise and glory and honor. You did not see him, yet you love him. And still, without seeing him, you are already filled with a joy so glorious that it cannot be described. Because you believe and you are sure of the end to which your faith looks forward, that is, the salvation of your souls.
And now, before we hear the Gospel sung in Latin and Greek, since this is the second Sunday of Easter, Divine Mercy Sunday, we listen to the sequence.
This is a beautiful ancient hymn. Christians to the Paschal Victim offer sacrifice and praise. The sheep are ransomed by the Lamb, and Christ the undefiled hath sinners to his Father reconciled. Death with life contended, combat strangely ended. Life's own champion slain, yet lives to reign. Tell us, Mary, say what you did see upon the way. The tomb the living did enclose. I saw Christ's glory as he rose. The angels there attesting, shroud with grave clothes resting. Christ, my hope, is risen. He goes before you into Galilee. That Christ is truly risen from the dead, we know. Victorious King, thy mercy show.
Christ,
We should say that the readings that are being used for this liturgy are the readings used throughout the world for today, the second Sunday of Easter, which has also been declared now to be Divine Mercy Sunday. And every year on this Sunday, the second Sunday of Easter, we have the beautiful Gospel of Thomas, sometimes wrongly called Doubting Thomas. He is the believer who dared express his sadness, his frustration, his honesty, his integrity, and he was blessed for that and becomes an instrument of blessing to the nations.
And the reading of the Gospel will begin in a moment from the book of John. This is EWTN's live continuing coverage of the canonization mass on this Divine Mercy Sunday for St. John the 23rd and St. John Paul the 2nd. Alleluia is filling this square, the Sistine Choir. This is the Gospel.
Lectio Sancti Evangelii secundum Johannem.
Gloria tibi Domine.
Reading from the Holy Gospel according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. In the evening of that same day, the first day of the week, the doors were closed in the room where the disciples were, for fear of the Jews. Jesus came and stood among them. He said to them, "Peace be with you," and showed them his hands and his side. The disciples were filled with joy when they saw the Lord. And he said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so am I sending you." After saying this, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. For those whose sins you forgive, they are forgiven. For those whose sins you retain, they are retained." Thomas, called the twin, who was one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. When the disciples said, "We have seen the Lord," he answered, "Unless I see the holes
got the nails made in his hands, and put my finger into the holes they made. And unless I can put my hand into his side, I refuse to believe. 8 days later, the disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. The doors were closed, but Jesus came in and stood among them. "Peace be with you," he said. Then he spoke to Thomas, "Put your finger here. Look, here are my hands. Give me your hand. Put it into my side. Doubt no longer, but believe." Thomas replied, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "You believe because you can see me. Happy are those who have not seen and yet believe." There were many other signs that Jesus worked and the disciples saw, but they are not recorded in this book. These are recorded so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing this, you may have life through his name.
Et noli fieri incredulos, sed fidelis. Respondit Thomas et dixit ei, Nominus meus et Deus meus. Dicit ei Iesus, quia vidisti me, credidisti. Beati qui noviderunt et crediderunt. Multa quidem et alia signa fecit Iesus in cospecto discipulorum suorum, quae non sum scripta in libro hoc. Ec autem scripta sunt, ut credati se quia Iesus est Christus filius Dei, et ut credentes vitam ea beatis in nomine Iesus. Verbum Domini.
The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And now the homily of Pope Francis, after a little sequence here.
Sophia orthia cussomentu agio evangeliu.
Eirini passi.
The Greek Gospel.
Reading the Gospel in Greek is a tradition at papal masses as a sign of his authority above Eastern and Western Christianity. And in the age of this ecumenical effort that Pope John Paul II, now Saint John Paul, promoted so greatly, it's a sign of affection for the Greek Orthodox and a desire that the Gospel of Christ become the source of unity in faith and in government.
Aftis irini min
και τούτο υπόν έδειξεν τας χείρας και την πλευράν αυτής. Εχάρισαν ούν οι μαθηταί δόντες των Κύριων, είπεν ούν αυτής ο Ιησούς πάλιν ειρήνη ημίν. Καθώς απέσταλκεν με ο Πατήρ, καγώ πέμπω ημάς. Και τούτο υπόν εν εφήσισεν και λέγει αυτής, λάβετε πνεύμα Άγιον. Αντίνον αφήτε τας αμαρτίας, αφέονται αυτής. Αντίνον κρατείτε και κράτηντε. Θωμάς δε εις εκ των δώδεκα ο λεγόμενος δίδυμος, ουκίν με ταυτόν ότε ήλθε Ιησούς. Έλεγον ουν αυτό οι άλλοι μαθητέ, εωράκαμεν τον Κύριον. Ο δε είπεν αυτοίς, εάν μη είδω εν τες χερσίν αυτού τον τύπον των ύλων και βάλω τον δάκτυλον μου εις τον τύπον των ύλων και βάλω μου την χείρα εις την πλευράν αυτού που μη πιστεύσω. Και με θυμέρας όκτω πάλιν ήσαν έσω οι μαθητέ αυτού και Θωμάς με ταυτόν. Έρχεται ο Ιησούς των θυρών και κλεισμένων και έστει εις το μέσον και είπεν ειρήνη μην. Ήτα λέγει το Θωμά, φέρε τον δάκτυλον σου όδε και είδε τας χειράς μου και φέρε την χειρά σου και βάλε εις την πλευράν μου και μη γίνου άπιστος αλλά πιστός. Απεκρίθη Θωμάς και είπεν αυτό, ο Κύριος μου και ο Θεός μου. Λέγει αυτό Ιησούς, ότι όρακας με πεπίστευκας, μακάρι οι μη ειδώντες και πιστεύσαντες. Πολλά μενούν και άλλα σημεία επίσεν ο Ιησούς ενώπιον των μαθητών αυτού, αουκέστην και γραμμένα εν το βιβλίο τούτο. Ταύτα δε γέγραπτε ή να πιστεύσετε ότι Ιησούς έστιν ο Χριστός, ο Υιός του Θεού, και ή να πιστεύοντες. Ζωήν έχετε εν το ονόματι αυτού.
And now we await the homily of Pope Francis at this canonization mass. Always a high point before the Eucharist. This is EWTN News Live, continuing coverage of the canonization mass for Saints John the 23rd and John Paul the 2nd. We are coming to you live from Rome.
blesses the faithful with the book of the Gospels, venerates it, a sign of the love and respect we have for the Holy Word of God.
Eager to hear his words to us here during this mass of canonization, coming to you live through Vatican Radio here in St. Peter's Square this morning.
Al centro di questa domenica che conclude l'ottava di Pasqua e che San Giovanni Paolo II ha voluto intitolare alla Divina Misericordia, ci sono le piaghe gloriose di Gesù risorto.
At the heart of this Sunday, which concludes the octave of Easter, and which John Paul II wished to dedicate to divine mercy, are the glorious wounds of the risen Jesus.
Quella sera, come abbiamo sentito, non c'era Tommaso.
He had already shown these wounds when he first appeared to the apostles on the very evening of that day following the Sabbath, the day of the resurrection. But Thomas, as we heard, was not there that evening. And when the others told him that they had seen the Lord, he replied that unless he himself saw and touched those wounds, he would not believe. A week later, Jesus appeared once more to the disciples gathered in the upper room, and Thomas was present. Jesus turned to him and told him to touch his wounds. Whereupon that man, so straightforward and accustomed to testing everything personally, knelt before Jesus with the words, "My Lord and my God."
Sono scandalo per la fede, ma sono anche la verifica della fede.
The wounds of Jesus are a scandal, a stumbling block for faith. Yet they're also the test of faith. That's why on the body of the risen Christ, the wounds never pass away. They remain, for those wounds are the enduring sign of God's love for us. They are essential for believing in God. Not for believing that God exists, but for believing that God is love, mercy, and faithfulness. Saint Peter, quoting Isaiah, writes to Christians, "By his wounds you have been healed."
Hanno avuto il coraggio di guardare le ferite di Gesù, di toccare le sue mani piagate e il suo costato trafitto.
John the 23rd and John Paul II were not afraid to look upon the wounds of Jesus, to touch his torn hands and his pierced side. They were not ashamed of the flesh of Christ. They were not scandalized by him, by his cross. They did not despise the flesh of their brother, because they saw Jesus in every person who suffers and struggles. These were two men of courage, filled with the parousia of the Holy Spirit. And they bore witness before the Church and the world to God's goodness and mercy. They were priests, bishops, and popes of the 20th century. They lived through the tragic events of that century, but they were not overwhelmed by them. For them, God was more powerful. Faith was more powerful. Faith in Jesus Christ, the Redeemer of man and the Lord of history. The mercy of God, shown by those five wounds, was more powerful. And more powerful, too, was the closeness of Mary, our mother.
E testimoni della sua misericordia, dimorava una speranza viva insieme con una gioia indicibile e gloriosa.
In these two men who looked upon the wounds of Christ and bore witness to his mercy, there dwelt a living hope and an indescribable and glorious joy. The hope and the joy which the risen Christ bestows on his disciples, the hope and the joy which nothing and no one can take from them. The hope and joy of Easter forged in the crucible of self-denial, self-emptying, utter identification with sinners, even to the point of disgust at the bitterness of that chalice. Such were the hope and the joy which these two holy popes had received as a gift from the risen Lord, and which they in turn bestowed in abundance upon the people of God, meriting our eternal gratitude.
E questa gioia si respiravano nella prima comunità dei credenti a Gerusalemme.
This hope and this joy were palpable in the earliest community of believers in Jerusalem, as we read in the Acts of the Apostles.
In cui si vive l'essenziale del Vangelo, vale a dire l'amore, la misericordia, in semplicità e fraternità.
It was a community which lived the heart of the gospel, love and mercy, in simplicity and fraternity. This is also the image of the Church, which the Second Vatican Council sent before us.
Hanno collaborato con lo Spirito Santo per ripristinare e aggiornare la Chiesa secondo la sua fisonomia originaria.
John the 23rd and John Paul II cooperated with the Holy Spirit in renewing and updating the Church in keeping with her pristine features, those features which the saints have given her throughout the centuries. Let us not forget that it is the saints who give direction and growth to the Church.
Ha dimostrato una delicata docilità allo Spirito Santo.
In convening the Council, John the 23rd showed an exquisite openness to the Holy Spirit. He let himself be led, and he was for the Church a pastor, a servant leader. This was his great service to the Church. I like to think of him as being the Pope of openness to the Spirit.
San Giovanni Paolo II è stato il Papa della famiglia.
In his own service to the people of God, Saint John Paul II was the Pope of the family. He himself once said that he wanted to be remembered as the Pope of the family. I'm particularly happy to point this out as we are in the process of journeying with families towards the Synod on the Family. It's surely a journey which, from his place in heaven, he guides and sustains us. May these two new saints and shepherds of God's people intercede for the Church, so that during this two-year journey toward the Synod, she may be open to the Holy Spirit in pastoral service to the family. May both of them teach us not to be scandalized by the wounds of Christ and to enter ever more deeply into the mystery of divine mercy, which always hopes and always forgives because it always loves.
Another very beautiful homily, simple, to the point, summarizing so beautifully these two great popes. We'll have an opportunity during the communion period to to draw some reflection from that homily and offer some points to our hearers and our viewers today.
It was a very brief and to-the-page homily. Pope Francis added nothing to this. Normally, he'll extemporize here and there. Not today. What did you hear here?
One thing I heard was at the beginning, the Pope said about the two new saints, they lived through the tragic events of the century, but they were not overwhelmed by them. That's, I think, one of the great themes that we're hearing today. The world does not rule the church. The church, in fact, guides and shapes the world amidst its troubles. And the Pope, as our leader, brings forth new graces for that struggle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I was struck toward the end, where in our translation, and we'll have to look at this later when we get the actual Italian transcript, but the translation was given us, he was the Pope of openness. This is about John the 23rd. But in fact, the word that I heard the Pope use was docilitat, docility, docileness, which is, means quite a bit different, something quite a bit different in our world. Openness tends to be one of those things that is undefined, but being docile, being willing to be led by the Holy Spirit, I think is a concept that's quite different.
So when he spoke of John the 23rd, he said, I see him as the Pope of docility.
Docility to the Holy Spirit.
And that would be consistent with what we spoke of earlier. When you read the Journal of a Soul, it's clear he is constantly relying, waiting for God to prompt him, and he's begging to hear God at every turn. We now will return you to the Mass. This is EWTN News, live, continuing coverage of this canonization Mass from St. Peter's in Rome. Pope Francis celebrating this Mass.
Thank you.
Dio Padre, che nella Pasqua del Signore Gesù ci ha raggiunti e salvati con la sua divina misericordia, innalziamo le preghiere che lo Spirito Santo suscita nel nostro cuore.
The prayers of the faithful. The first is in read in Spanish. Through the prayers of the Blessed Virgin Mary and Saint Joseph, make your church, Lord, radiant with the beauty of new life. In her may all people encounter Jesus, risen and alive.
In Arabic, Father, through the prayers of the apostles and evangelists, pour out your spirit on sinners and those led astray in their dark night. May they encounter Jesus risen and alive. Let us pray to the Lord. Pray, Lord, hear us.
Father, through the prayers of the martyrs and confessors of the faith, keep holy our brothers and sisters reborn in the Easter sacraments. In them may all people know the presence of Jesus risen and alive.
And now the prayer in Chinese.
天父,
Father, through the prayers of Saint John the 23rd, help the leaders of nations in their thoughts and decisions to reject every escalation of hatred and violence. May all human relations reveal the victory of Jesus, risen and alive. Let us pray to the Lord.
Par l'intercession de Saint Jean-Paul II, suscite toujours au
French, read by Sister Marie Simon Pierre, the French sister, a hospital nurse who was cured through the intercession of Blessed John Paul II, at the time the miracle required for the beatification. Father, through the prayers of Saint John Paul II, continue to inspire a passionate commitment to human dignity among men and women of culture, science, and government. In every person, may honor be given to Jesus, risen and alive. Let us pray to the Lord. Lord, hear our prayer.
Riconosci, oh Padre, nella nostra voce la voce di Gesù risorto e nella potenza della sua risurrezione colmaci con la sua.
The Holy Father concludes by asking God, in our voices hear the voice of the risen Jesus, and by the power of his resurrection grant us the fullness of your salvation.
And now as the liturgy of the Eucharist begins, it was curious, Father, that there was no Polish prayer there, no petition in Polish.
I was really surprised because the largest group here, aside from people of Italy, are Polish pilgrims, and would have been appropriate. They also use, at these masses, usually have more than five petitions, so they had to make a decision, I guess, to restrict the number, but I think that's an oversight.
Yeah. given that you have half of Poland here today.
Yeah, and you know, these language groups like Polish that are a little bit out of the mainstream like to be affirmed as present in the church. It seems it would have been appropriate to have a Polish and maybe even an Italian prayer.
Well, there should have been one in Italian, one in Polish for the great son of Italy and the son of Poland. 1,700 buses came here from Poland. These people, they just arrived. They're going to get back on those buses after this Mass and return home. That is an arduous trip. It would have been nice, I think, to have heard their tongue. But to have seen John Paul raised to the altars, perhaps, is enough.
You can't dampen the enthusiasm of the sons of Poland.
No, and it's remarkable that there was applause that broke out when Pope Francis mentioned that John Paul wanted to be known as the Pope of the family.
Yes.
Quite spontaneously, the St. Peter's Square broke out into applause.
This is EWTN Live, continuing coverage of this massive canonization, this Divine Mercy Sunday. From St. Peter's Square, Raymond Arroyo joined on set by Robert Royal and Father Jerry Murray. We will now let you hear the beautiful sounds of this Sistine Choir.
Thank you.
The civil authorities of Rome just announced that in the area around St. Peter's Square, which includes the Vatican area, Via Conciliazione, and right down to the bridges, there are 500,000 people at least. And including the piazzas, the Piazza Navona, the Fori Imperiali, the Circo Massimo, a total of 800,000 people altogether. That's not bad for the second Sunday of Easter.
But remember that their jumbo mega screens have been set up in some of these squares around the city to allow people who weren't able to get close enough to St. Peter's Square to participate in the canonization mass.
~150 cardinals, including Pope Emeritus Benedict, 1,000 bishops.
Acceptabili fiat apud Deum Patrem Omnipotentem. Sussi pequesmus Domine, plebis tui oblationes, ut confessione tui in omnis et baptisma te renovati, sempiternam beatitudinem consequantur. Per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
Dominus obiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sursum corda.
Agnesus ad Dominum.
Gratias agamus, Domino Deo nostro. Vere dignum et justum est, ecum et salutare, te quidem Domine omni tempore confiteri, sed in ac potissimum die, gloriosius predicare, con Pascha nostrum immolatus est Christus. Ipse enim verus est agnus qui abstulit peccata mundi, qui mortem nostram moriendo destruxit, et vitam resurgendo reparavit. Qua propter profusis pascalibus gaudiis, toto in orbe terrarum mundus exultat, sed in superne virtutes ad evangelice potestates, innum gloriae tue concinum sine fine dicentes.
Be wondering, how will all of these people receive Holy Communion? It's very carefully planned. For St. Peter's Square and the altar area, 70 deacons will be distributing Holy Communion. for the Via Conciliazione. There are 70 more deacons that are gathered right now in the Church of Santa Maria Traspontina, there to the left down the Via Conciliazione. It's the titular church of Cardinal Marc Ouellet from Quebec, who's now the prefect of the Congregation of Bishops.
Vere Santus est Domine, et merito te laudam Domini sancte condita creatura, quia per filium tuum, Dominum nostrum Iesu Christum, Spiritus Sancti operante virtute, vivificas et sanctificas universa, et populum tibi congregare non destinis, ut a solis orto usque ad occasum oblatio munda offerator nomini tuo. Supplices ergo te, Domine, deprecamur, ut ec munera que tibi sacranda de tulimus, eodem spiritus sanctificare digneris, ut corpus et sanguis fian fili tui Domini nostri Iesu Christi, cuius mandato ec misteria celebramus. Ipse enim, in qua nocte tradebatur, accepit panem, et tibi gratias agens benedixit. Fregit, dedicque discipulis suis, dices, accipite et manducate ex hoc omnes. Hoc est enim corpus meum, quod pro vobis tradetur. Simile modo, postquam cenatum est, accipiens calicem, et tibi gratias agens benedixit, dedicque discipuli suis dicens, accipite, et vivite ex eo omnes. Hic est enim calis sanguinis mei, novi et eterni testamenti, qui pro vobis et pro multis effundetur in remissionem peccatorum. Hoc facite in meam commemorationem.
Mysterium fidei.
Memore sigitur Domine, eius en fili tui salutifere passionis, nec non mirabilis resurrectionis et ascensionis in celum, sed prestolantes alterum eius adventum, offerimus tibi, gratias referentes, hoc sacrificium vivum et santum. Respice quesumus in oblationem ecclesiae tue, et agnoscens ostiam, cuius voluisti immolazione placari, concede, ut qui corpore et sanguine, fili tui reficimu, Spiritus Sancti repleti, unum corpus et unus spiritus inveniamur in Christo.
Ipse nos tibi perficiat munus aeternum, ut cum electis tuis hereditatem consequi valeamus, in primis cum Beatissima Virgine Dei Genitrice Maria, cum Beato Iosef e Sponso, ac Beatis Apostolis tuis, et gloriosis martiribus, cum Santo Ioanne et Ioanne Paolo, et omnibus santis, quorum intercessione, perpetua put te confidimus adiuvari.
Ec ostia nostra reconciliationis proficiat, quesumus Domine, a totius mundi pacem atque salutem. Ecclesiam tuam, peregrinantem in terra, in fide caritate firmare dignieris, cum famolo tuo, Papa nostro Francisco, cum episcopali ordine et universo clero, et ogni popolo acquisitionis tue. Voti suius familie, quantivi a stare voluisti ad esto propitius. Omnes filios tuos, ubique dispersos, tibi, clemens pater, miseratus coniunge. Fratres nostros defuntos, et omnes qui tibi placentes ex os seculo transierunt, in regnum tuum benignus admitte, ubi fore speramus, ut simul gloria tua perenniter satiemur, per Christum Dominum nostrum, per quem mundo bona cunta largiris.
Per ipso et cum ipso et in ipso, est tibi Deo Patri Omnipotenti, in unitate Spiritus Sancti, omnis honor et gloria, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Precepti salutaribus moniti e divina institutione formati audemus dicere. Quae sumus Domini ab omnibus malis, da propitius pacem in diebus nostris, ut ope misericordiae tue adiuti, et a peccatos simus semper liberi, et ab omni perturbatione securi, spectantes beatam spem, et adventum salvatoris nostri Iesu Christi. Domine Iesu Christi, qui dixisti apostolis tuis, pacem relinquo vobis, pacem meam do vobis. Ne respicias peccata nostra, se fiden ecclesiae tue, e anque, secundum voluntatem tuam, pacificare e quadunare dignieris. Qui vivis et regnas in saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Offerte vobis pacem.
Thank you.
Pecce Agnusei et Cecitolis peccata mundi. Beati che al cena nagni vocati sunt.
The Holy Father receives Holy Communion now, and Communion is being brought to the major concelebrants who are seated to the left here, that is, the 1,000 or so bishops, about 150 cardinals, and of course to Pope Emeritus Benedict.
And we saw the lines of priests making their way through the congregation, not only in St. Peter's Square, but all the way down through Via della Conciliazione as well.
And in each of these piazzas and gathering places, priests of the Diocese of Rome and deacons will be distributing Holy Communion. As we said, about 800,000 people altogether taking part in the ceremony here in Rome, 500,000 alone just in this area. Very interesting point is if you look at the crowds and in the quadrants, there are few chairs. The only chairs that you see are for the front section. That means that the vast majority of the 800,000 people are without seats, and many of them have been here waiting in line to attend this since 6 o'clock last evening.
This is EWTN News Live, continuing coverage of Pope Francis's Mass of canonization for John Paul II and John the 23rd, the two latest saints in the Roman Catholic Church. I'm joined on set by Father Jerry Murray and Robert Royal. Your observation so far as we watch the distribution of communion, and we should say two of the Franciscan friars from down in Birmingham, out amongst this throng. They're part of the priests going out into the deep crowds here, which go all the way down the Via Conciliazione, handing out communion.
It's very moving to see Pope Benedict, Pope Emeritus Benedict, concelebrating the Mass, seeing how many of his cardinals came to greet him as they were passing by him after the Lamb of God. And it's really a historic occasion for us to celebrate with two popes this Mass and to bring to a holy conclusion this life and legacy of Pope John Paul II, really the outstanding saint and God-given figure of the 20th century. And now, as a saint in heaven, he will intercede for the Church as she in the 21st century continues that new evangelization project. Very, very moving to see Pope Benedict, who was his right-hand man, concelebrating this Mass.
So many have tweeted us that they are watching this in Cleveland, in Detroit, at St. Cyril and Methodius in Michigan, or in Chicago, rather, in Canada, Scotland, all around the world, even in the Colosseum here, where they are apparently simulcasting our coverage. And it's delightful to see the world once again gathering around John Paul II, the man who took the Church to the world in such a personal and profound way.
You know, there's a phrase, there's an age when giants walk the earth, and he was one of the giants. Yeah. We shouldn't forget John the 23rd either at this moment, because sometimes said that the Second Vatican Council was the most important religious event of the entire 20th century. So in several respects, what's happening today, this very moving, beautiful ceremony that we're witnessing, is kind of putting a, you could call it a period or an exclamation point at the end of a particular moment in our global Catholic history that I think will be with, even though it's past now, it will be with people for a very long time.
I don't think it's past, and that's the joy of this, watching these little children named, like your son, John Paul, watching people whose lives, they feel he so intimately touched their lives, and though some of them, most of them, never met the man person to person, they feel heart to heart they were united, and that he obviously shifted something in the way they lived their lives or awakened them to something they were called to do. And that witness was so compelling, so all-enveloping, that they were moved.
Well, if you go to my Catholic website, The Catholic Thing Today, you will see a very moving memoir by a priest called Father Gerald Murray about how John Paul II influenced actually his own and reinforced his own decision to become a priest. And I think that, Father, what you wrote is very beautiful, but it could be written, maybe not with the same panache that you brought to it, but it could be written by many, many people out there who maybe didn't go into the priesthood, maybe they did, but you're quite right, Raymond, that it shifted internally the spirit of many, many people in the 20th century and beyond.
Thanks for mentioning that, Bob. The article reflects my great love for now St. John Paul II. When I was a student at Dartmouth College in New Hampshire, our chaplain, Monsignor Bill Nolan, organized a bus down to Boston Common in October of 1979 when St. John Paul II visited and said Mass. And that day it rained. Now, thank the Lord it didn't rain today on this canonization Mass. But it rained, but the Pope said Mass, and his homily was about the rich young man who could not say yes to the Lord because he had many possessions. And I think what we call the John Paul the second generation, now the St. John Paul the second generation, I saw that yesterday. I was in the square walking around, and I met the students from the University of Dallas Rome campus. And they came down early to camp out and to be here. And I visited that campus, visited other schools. This young generation loved the Pope because he taught them being a Catholic is the source of not only their religious identity, it's their whole life. Everything about why we're on planet Earth is summed up in Jesus Christ. And it's expressed, as we do now, in Mass, reception of Holy Communion. This is what it means to be a Catholic. That's why John Paul II is so inspiring. He was truly a man who loved the Lord.
For those of you just joining us, this is EWTN's coverage. You're looking at Pope Benedict, the emeritus pope there, in prayer as the communion is being distributed. Would I love to hear what his thoughts are at this moment, being back on this very public stage in St. Peter's Square again. It's the first time he's been publicly in this square. You're watching it. He hasn't been back since his retirement a year ago. And you are really witnessing a family reunion. You see those two great popes, their images now adoring the front of St. Peter's Basilica. It's not unlike walking into a family home and seeing the two pictures of your grandpapa's on the wall, and this is a tribute and a celebration of these lives. Many of these people have traveled from other continents to be here and sacrificed an enormous amount. The rates of hotels here in Rome are very expensive. These people spent the night out in sleeping bags. They came by bus, some of them walked. I mean, it's an amazing sacrifice and a beautiful moment. They're the relics of the two saints, the vial of blood for John Paul and a piece of John the 23rd skin on the right-hand side there.
You know, as Americans, we're very proud of the fact that our society is open and people move from the humblest circumstances up to presidencies and such. And I think we often forget that the church has something very similar to this. We're looking at a picture there of John the 23rd, who grew up in a very humble circumstance up near Bergamo here in Italy. 13 children in a family of a farmer. And then John Paul II, brought up by a father who was a widower, who actually had to work in a factory, a chemical factory, as a young man, under communism, when it was very hard to be openly Catholic. And I noticed in one of the videos that we're seeing a lot of reminiscences of these groups, and I noticed that he talked about how being in a clandestine seminary was so important to his spiritual formation, that it hardened him in a way that he was able to persist with all the challenges that he later faced.
We're going to let you enjoy some of the beautiful music during this moment of reflection following communion as we continue to cover this historic canonization Mass from St. Peter's Square.
May these two saints and shepherds intercede for us during this two-year journey. I see this homily looking back to the sacred scriptures, remembering these two great witnesses to hope in John the 23rd and John Paul II, and looking forward to the journey that still lies before us.
What a beautiful reading. Thank you, Father Tom. Thank you for helping us to enter more fully into the spirit and substance of the homily that we heard earlier on.
Here the camera is going through the section of the heads of state, the government delegations, 93 of them, many heads of state, heads of government delegations, of parliament, of senates, of all kinds of government representatives, and of course the ambassadors, the diplomatic corps. Today is the second Sunday of Easter, also is Divine Mercy Sunday. What a beautiful day to have this canonization, to, in a sense, to offer to the world one of the great gifts of Pope John Paul II in handing us over, passing on to us the Divine Mercy devotion. You know, we remember at the beginning of his pontificate, 1981, second encyclical he wrote, Divus in Misericordia, rich in mercy, God is rich in mercy, that illustrated the heart of the mission of Jesus Christ. And he referred back to this sister, a Polish nun, Sister Faustino Kowalska, and he beatified her in 1993. In that homily of her beatification, he wrote, her mission continues and is yielding astonishing fruits. It's truly marvelous how her devotion to the merciful Jesus is spreading in our contemporary world and gaining so many hearts. 4 years later, then, in 1997, he visited Faustina's tomb in Poland, and he also had some powerful words. There's nothing that man needs more than divine mercy, mercy, mercy. From there, he went on to the message of mercy that Christ himself chose to pass on to our generation. Then, of course, in the Jubilee year, in 2000, he canonized Sister Faustina, Blessed Faustina, making her the first canonized saint of the new millennium. And he established Divine Mercy Sunday that year, on this Sunday. He said, Jesus shows his hands and his side to the apostles. He points, that is, to the wounds of his passion. Again, that whole theme of the wounds. What Pope Francis did today was brilliant. He drew from this source. Jesus' heart is the source from which flows the great wave of mercy poured out on humanity. Throughout his priestly and episcopal ministry, and especially during the entire pontificate, John Paul II preached God's mercy, he wrote about it, and most important, he lived it. He offered it to the man who was destined to kill him in St. Peter's Square in 1981. He witnessed the scandals of division among Christians and the atrocities against the Jewish people as he grew up. Everything in his power was used to heal the wounds of the historic conflicts between Catholics and the Christian churches, and especially the enmity that existed between Christians and the Jewish people. So it's very fitting that today, on this day, the Church canonizes another great apostle of mercy, John Paul II. I'll never forget his parting words at the World Youth Day in Toronto in 2002. I remember standing behind his chair as he leaned up against the podium. He could barely stand, and he said, at difficult moments in the Church's life, the pursuit of holiness becomes even more urgent. And holiness is not a question of age. it's a matter of living in the Holy Spirit. Today it's a chance for the whole church to pray in gratitude for John Paul II and for also the mercy that was given to the world through the kindness, the sweetness, the paternal care, the great humor of St. John the 23rd. They go very well together, and the two of them entrusted to us the Second Vatican Council. It is not something of the past. It is a continuing story, a work in progress, if you will. John being the dreamer, the one who gave it to us, John Paul II, the interpreter, the authoritative interpreter and the teacher, reminding us that this council is only beginning.
I see you have a prayer here as well. Huh? It's a prayer of gratitude. Is that something you would like to read for us?
It's a good time for us in this moment of communion, of thanksgiving. O God, you are rich in mercy, and you willed that St. John Paul II should preside as Pope over your universal Church. Grant, we pray, that instructed by his teaching, we may open our hearts to the saving grace of Christ, the sole Redeemer of the human family, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Let us take a few moments just to reflect on what we just experienced.
Rimaniamo alcuni istanti in silenzio orante.
Let us keep prayerful silence for some brief moments.
Guardemos silencio por unos instantes y permanezcamos en oración.
Trwajmy kilka chwil w cichej modlitwie.
Silence in St. Peter's Square as this vast crowd, 500,000 people, pray their thanks to God for allowing us to the gift of John Paul II and John the 23rd. And we go back for a moment again together with you, Father Tom, on Pope Francis' reflections during that brief but very powerful homily. You are the scripture scholar, you are the expert in your Greek and Latin and so forth. From a layperson's perspective, very simply, one of the things that struck me was the use of that verb to touch. He uses it three times at the beginning. He uses it in reference to Thomas, but then he uses it also in reference to John the 23rd and to Pope John Paul II, as not being afraid to touch the wounds of Christ. This very tactile approach, which Francis has in a sense, we see him, the way he deals with sick or disabled people, unafraid to touch those wounds.
Oremos. Concede questum Domine, o Pascalis perceptio sacramenti,
continua in nostri mentibus perseveret, per Christum Dominum nostrum.
Amen.
We'll come back to that in a moment, if you don't mind. We're at this point in the celebration, we're awaiting the final words.
Prima di concludere questa festa della fede, desidero salutare e ringraziare tutti voi.
This is Pope Francis. He'll be praying the Regina Coeli in a few moments, but before he's expressing his gratitude, saying, before concluding this feast of faith, as he calls it, he'd like to greet and thank all those present. He thanks the cardinals and the great number of bishops and priests from every part of the world. He says he's grateful to the official delegations from so many countries who've come to render homage to two popes who contributed in an indelible way to the cause of the development of people and peace. I especially think of the Italian authorities, he says, and thank them for their precious collaboration.
Con grande affetto saluto I pellegrini delle diocesi di Bergamo e di Cracovia.
The applause is because the Pope says he thinks with great, he greets with great affection the pilgrims from the dioceses of Bergamo and Krakow in particular. May you continue to honor the memory of the two holy popes and faithfully follow their teachings. I'm grateful also, says Pope Francis, to all those who with such generosity have prepared these memorable days, including the Diocese of Rome with Cardinal Bellini, the Rome Municipality, the Mayor of Rome, Ignazio Marino, the Armed Forces of Italy and various organizations, and the numerous volunteer associations. Thank you all.
Il mio saluto va a tutti I pellegrini qui in piazza San Pietro, nelle strade adiacenti.
The Pope also greets the pilgrims here in St. Peter's Square, in the streets nearby and around the city of Rome. He also greets all of you, joined with us at this moment by radio and television. And Pope Francis thanks the media professionals who've, through their work, have allowed so many people to participate in this celebration. I send a special greeting, he says, to the sick and to the aged, those to whom the new saints were especially close. Now let us turn our attention in prayer to the Virgin Mary, who Saint John the 23rd and Saint John Paul the 2nd loved as true sons.
Amen.
Oremos, Deus que per resurrezione Fili Tui Domini Nostri Gesù Cristi, mondo un letificare degnatus est. Presta quesum, ut per eius genetrice in Vergine Maria, perpetua capiamus gaudia vite per il Christum Dominum Nostrum.
Amen.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto. Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sic erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Gloria Patri et Filio et Spiritui Sancto.
Sic erat in principio, et nunc et semper, et in saecula saeculorum. Amen.
Profidebus et fontis, requiem aeterna donae mine.
Et lustre perpetua nocere
eius. Requiescant in pace.
Amen.
Dominus obiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Sin nomen Domini benedictum.
Et hoc nunc et usque in saeculum.
Adiutorium nostrum in nomine Domini.
Qui fece caelum et terra.
Benedicat vos omnipotens Deus, Pater, et Filius, et Spiritus Sanctus.
Amen.
Ite missa est, alleluia, alleluia.
Pope Francis makes his way over to Pope Benedict. An historic, beautiful shot. If the cameraman would move out of the way, there we go. A lovely moment, the two popes meeting, the emeritus as well as the current pope. And now Pope Francis will make his way into the Popemobile. He will surround and embrace this crowd. He's going to go up and down the all over St. Peter's Square. And will he go down the Via Conciliazione?
He's scheduled to, yes.
Aha. Mm-hmm. Because this crowd is immense, as you can tell from that wide shot. Now, still on set is the canonization crew. Robert Royal, the editor-in-chief of thecatholicthing.org, and Father Jerry Murray of the Archdiocese of New York. And we are so pleased to be joined by our EWTN News Bureau chief, Joan Lewis, the purveyor of all that is in
all
Rome.
All that you wanted to know and were afraid to ask.
No, right? and know who to ask.
Exactly.
Forget about afraid to.
Exactly.
Joan, what was your impression of this incredible event, historic event?
I had to be in the square at the rite of canonization because I've spoken to three of the four popes today, John Paul, Benedict, and Francis, and I was in the presence, as we know from my shows, of John the 23rd. Mm. So the impact of these four men on my life, and I was down there, and I have to say, tears came to my eyes. It was a very moving moment. It's a gorgeous ceremony. We have two men to pray to. Now we have 82 popes who are canonized. Mm. Up till this morning, there were 80. So we have 82 canonized popes, people we can pray to for their intercession.
Yeah, and for those of us who knew John Paul II, It is overwhelming. I was telling the gentleman earlier in our audience, Cardinal Jivic was up here yesterday. You had just left. You just missed him, but you've seen him so many times. And when he came in, it was like something was uncorked in me. I was just so moved by the encounter with him, because he so reminds me of John Paul, and I guess I almost conflate them together. Yeah.
John Paul and his shadow.
Yeah.
And I have been trying to imagine for 3 days what he, Cardinal Jivic, is feeling inside. Mm. I, at a greater distance, I met John Paul about 20 times, mm. and then have had actually several conversations, and it's always so moving. It's like putting your finger in an electric socket, the what you feel when that moment happens. And I don't know about you all, but with me, you talk to a Pope, everything around you disappears.
Yeah.
All other people, you can't even describe the scenery.
Yeah.
It's very special.
Gentlemen, your impression of this event?
I'm reminded of the title of the encyclical, Veritatis Splendor, the splendor of the truth. And I think that's what we've experienced today, the truth of God's goodness, his providence. He raised up men, John Paul II and John the 23rd, to rule his church and lead us in faith. And the reaction to God's grace is manifest in the million people who are here. Yeah. And what are we here for? We're here to pray to God. We're here for Mass. We're here to worship the Lord. And to join, really, as they say, the saints surround us.
This is the President of Italy greeting Pope Francis. Some of the dignitaries still there under that awning you see behind the President.
And that's the first time, if I may say so, Raymond, they have ever put up an awning for any ceremony at the Vatican.
They expected rain today.
Well, I'm just going to say that's a John the 23rd second miracle, because we were supposed to be sitting in a 90% chance of pouring rain. Mm-hmm. And so
and
we
it's
have
anything but. No, the sun is actually starting to peek out, which, much to my chagrin, they're turning up these, you know, these lights in here. The Pope is now meeting this is the President of Spain.
That's King Juan Carlos and Queen Sofia. Mm-hmm. And a reigning queen is the only one who may wear white in the presence of a Pope.
Yes. Look at that.
Very nice.
What was very striking about today, and I hope this does get a lot of coverage, was the fact of the importance and size of Jewish and Orthodox delegations. And if you actually go back to John the 23rd, you think of his years in Turkey, all the Muslims, right. You think of his contacts with Jews and other religions. He was the first to start an opening to the other faiths and start a dialogue.
We should talk a bit about that. We have some of that footage of both John Paul and John the 23rd reaching out particularly to other faiths, Protestants, other people in the Christian community, as well as to the people in the Jewish faith. Your thoughts on this and the great progress they both made?
Yeah, I think that we're all very emotional at this moment. And one of the things that I find myself surprised at in my own feelings is the way that the universality of the church, somewhat represented by the Latin Mass that we just heard, because what language are you going to have this in other than Latin,
right,
that would not be sort of a neutral point? But it's both universal and large, and yet very personal and direct to other people. So it's not a surprise that these two popes in particular, who were such personable human beings, are able to carry a universality. It seems something of a paradox, but I think it really incarnates what the two of them were very much like.
And if you read a lot of books, short stories, anything about John, one thing he seemed to say a dozen times a day was, but there are brothers and sisters. No matter who he was talking about, somebody was poor, somebody rich, somebody of another faith, he always insisted on, but there are brothers and sisters.
Yes, and actually that's the dignity of the human person, the central theme of John Paul II's preaching, is a reflection of that conviction. Our Jewish brethren are our brothers, they truly are. And we have to look at all mankind, not as strangers, people from a different tribe, a different religion. We're all united in Christ, either actually or potentially, and the love of Christ extends through his church to all mankind.
And John Paul had such a closeness to the Jewish people, given the Polish experience. They were in his neighborhood, there was neighbors, his friends. And you see that affection still going out. In fact, there are many Jewish people here, some I encountered in the last few days, who have come this way to be here for this moment, even though they're not Catholic at all. Many Protestant friends are dropping in. They're emailing us, telling us, and tweeting us, saying, you know, I'm not Catholic, but I couldn't stay away from this moment because of their personal attachment to this particular man, this particular Pope and witness. Let's talk for a moment about Pope Francis's homily before we have to leave you. There was one moment where he said, talking about both the popes, he said they lived through the tragic events of that century, the 20th century, but they were not overwhelmed by them. For them, God was more powerful. Faith was more powerful. Faith in Jesus Christ, the Redeemer of man and the Lord of history. The mercy of God shown by those five wounds, the wounds of Christ, were more powerful. Give me your impression of that synthesis, if you will, of these two pontificates, these two saints.
Well, as we know, the 20th century, for all its advances and all its progress, was also a century that was quite bloody. That at least 100,000 people, 100 million people perished under communism, and 40 million more or so under Nazism. So it was a bloody century. And when the Pope said that they didn't allow this to overwhelm them, it's remarkable that they were both involved in overcoming these two terrible systems that produced such heartache and actually oppressed the church as well during the course of the 20th century. So it was put, I think, not very specifically, it was put in very broad terms, but it's good for us to recognize that we overcame something, particularly through the papacy, that in some ways still remains a challenge. We're still in the culture of death that has to be reversed into a culture of life.
Nazism and communism represented an evil attempt by man to dethrone God and enslave the humanity in a system that's completely against the nature of man. John Paul II lived under it, he fought it, and where are the Nazis today? They're gone. The communists, almost gone. But the secularists, as he says...
And he fought it to the very end. He fought that secularist, that atheistic mindset. Joan, you and I met the first time in Cairo when you were part of that very important delegation, which was really one of the last great battles of John Paul's life on the international stage. You had the Cairo conference and the UN absolutely dedicated to proclaiming abortion as a human right. It was only through prayer and this feisty witness and what happened on the ground that changed that.
When he sent our delegations off to Cairo and then a year later to Beijing,
to China,
he received us before the talks began, not afterwards to thank us. He said, today you need a cheerleader. Tomorrow you're leaving, you know, for parts unknown. You need a cheerleader. Please know that I'm here and I'm serious. If you need to pick up the phone and call me, do it. But I want you to know I'm praying for you. And it was a battle, actually, interestingly enough. Navarro Valls was the one who put on the front page of all the papers the Vatican. And so it was like the UN and the Vatican fighting for human rights. We were and are today the voice of the voiceless.
Yeah. Yeah, and this was central to John Paul's vision, this notion of human dignity, religious freedom, and that idea of conscience and having it stopped by an international body or any governmental body was so abhorrent to him because he had lived it.
But what you're saying today in the three of you about the homily, what I heard were three words. These popes lived, do not be not afraid. Mm. And the Pope is asking us to be not afraid. Because we today look in our own country, if nowhere else.
In several ways, it's a more difficult circumstance. When you had a communist regime that you could oppose, there was a clear us and them. When you had a Nazi regime, we live in a time where the threats to life are much more subtle. They present themselves as scientific and medical and helpful. And so it's the spirit has got to be now carried on and applied in a more subtle but still very vigorous way.
Absolutely. In fact, it's the Pope spent a lot of time with scientists. He liked to know the progress of the sciences. Right. He was very interested in the threats against the human being created by scientific progress. His ideas about the dignity of human being were not secularist ideas about achieving human fulfillment. They were about preserving man so that he could worship God freely and in that regard love his neighbor for who he was. All these coercive manipulative systems that he suffered under, and frankly secularist mindset in the West is also very coercive, he recognized individuals disappear, the collectivity dictates. We can't have that. Mm-hmm. The church is not a collectivity, the church is a family. And in that family, truth is what we focus on, not personalities. Mm-hmm. That's truly what John Paul II represented.
We've been getting a lot of tweets and we will continue to take them. I know some of you have questions. Some of you, this is the first papal event you've ever seen and the first time you've seen a canonization. So I know you have a lot of questions. We'll get to a few of them. There was one that came in earlier and they said, it was from an atheist, and they said, why are you worshiping dead men? You would say what, Father Murray?
Heavens.
First of all, we don't worship men, we worship God. Secondly, John Paul II is very much alive, John the 23rd is alive, they are saints in heaven. And what we do is we go to them the way we go to anyone else and say, help me by your prayers, bring me closer to God. You're close to God, I want to be with you. I think that's, atheists sometimes get the misimpression that we create this mythical structure to console ourselves. It's not that at all. We recognize what God's done. God has made these men holy.
Mm-hmm. We venerate holiness. We venerate the person who embodied heroic virtues. We'd love to be that heroically virtuous. Mm-hmm. And now we can have someone and say, John, help me.
I live in Washington, D.C., and it's only natural to want to honor great human beings. We have what almost look like Greek temples to Abraham Lincoln, to Thomas Jefferson, that obelisk to Washington. George Washington. But it's a natural human impulse. And we just happen to believe, as Father says, that it continues beyond the grave, that those people are still there in reality. This is not something we've made up. They're there in reality. We can be in solidarity with them. We can pray to them. To pray for us. And it's just a recognition of Christianity.
And this is what is known as the communion of saints. The family goes on, whether it's this side of the veil or the other, it's all one family. And that's the notion here. I think that's a little hard for some people to absorb, even some fellow Christians, because there is this mindset that, well, great to see you here, Robert, but when you die, you know, I kind of move on and, you know, we put flowers out every now and then, but you're a thing of the past. In the Catholic Church, you really are very much alive. You pray for that person, or you ask for that person's prayer as you would in life. And that's what's happening here. We aren't, and the Catholic Church isn't attempting to say John Paul is, you know, has some mystical powers or divine power. No, he is closer to God at this point than we are, and therefore his intercession, the same prayer he had when he was living in that corner room, continues. But it's more powerful now because of his proximity to the
last Savior. Canonization I went to in the square was for St. Jose Maria Escriva, the founder of Opus Dei. And many, when you think, why would you honor that man? Why would you honor this? Because they brought us closer to God here on earth, and they're going to keep doing it from heaven. And this is not mysticism of a crazy sort. The dead people are not really dead. They're with us. They're with us in spirit, and through God's grace, we are with them.
The Church talks about being born into a new life at a funeral mass.
That's right.
So you have birth, you have life, and that's what we're all saying that we're all about.
We are about to take a little break, but before we do that, Joan, I want to share with the viewers, there were some pictures you took of John the 23rd, whom you attended a ceremony. Was it in St. Peter's? Where was this?
There was no audience hall at the time, but the Hall of Blessings, where today you see the balconies adorned with the images and the flowers, behind those windows is the Hall of Blessings. Mm-hmm. Several hundred people, and that's where John was carried in on the gestatorial chair by, I think, 8 or 10 liveried men. And that was the first pope I ever was in the presence of.
And you snapped that color picture of him.
Yes, and that's
and
the
that's
amazing
one of the rare
Arturo
color
Mari,
pictures
55
that exist.
Years at the Vatican Observatory as the photographer. I gave him copies, and he said, this is wonderful because they're rare and in color. And I gave Cardinal Capovilla, his secretary, copies. Mm-hmm. So if you go on the Vatican website, John the 23rd's pontificate is all in black and white.
Wow.
So we'll have to add my photos.
Oh, well, we have to get a Jones version of his pontificate. We're going to take a very quick break. When we return, more continuing coverage. Pope Francis still meeting with these world leaders, the various delegations assembled. This is part of the other hat he wears, the head of the Vatican City State. You have to greet the other heads of government and heads of state. He is doing that, and then he'll be driven through St. Peter's Square to greet this enthusiastic crowd that's come to commemorate these canonizations of Saints John Paul II and John the 23rd. Stay with us. More EWTN News continuing coverage from Rome in a moment.
Thank you.
23rd. I'm Raymond Arroyo, joined on set once again by my canonization crew, Robert Royal, the editor-in-chief of thecatholicthing.org, and Father Jerry Murray of the Archdiocese of New York. Thank you both for staying with us through this entire proceeding. Isn't it always?
We just did it for you.
I know you do. Let's talk for a moment about, before we leave everyone, this homily where he mentioned, Pope Francis did, John the 23rd and John Paul II cooperated with the Holy Spirit in renewing and updating the Church in keeping with her pristine features, while features which the saints have given her throughout the century, those features which the saints have given her throughout the centuries. Then he went on to say, the Pope, John the 23rd, he had an openness, according to the translation, an openness to the Spirit. And then he invoked the upcoming two-year journey toward the Synod, and he asked the intercession of these two saints that that she may be open to the Holy Spirit in pastoral service to the family. Your thoughts on all of this?
I think it was something of a surprise that Synod appeared at the end of this homily.
Really?
At least for me, I wouldn't have expected in this circumstance that he would have immediately referred to something that has now become part of his program. But I guess maybe in retrospect it makes sense if he would like to coordinate what he's actually doing with this legacy that he's received from these two prior popes. And of course, when he mentioned that Pope John Paul II wanted to be called the Pope of the Family, spontaneous applause erupted down here in the piazza. Mm-hmm. So there's something going on here that we can hope will be a continuation of something that was very powerful in these two earlier men, and that clearly this pope wished to affirm at the very conclusion of this homily.
Well, during the homily itself, you were listening in the Italian, and I tweeted out that when the pope said John the 23rd, according to this translation, John the 23rd is a pope of openness, what he actually said was docility.
Docility, the docilità.
It's a big difference.
Yeah, which is quite a big
difference. It is a big difference. Docility means being willing to be taught and led into the truth. Openness is sort of like you open a door, you don't know what's going to come through. It's not a good translation, openness, but docility also reminds us that one of the gifts of the Holy Spirit is knowledge. So what we should be doing now is praying in preparation for the Synod and rereading Familiaris Consortio, which is the great apostolic exhortation of St. John Paul II on the family. A wonderful document. It gives all kinds of positive orientations. Very aware of the current difficulties that families face.
Mm-hmm. You see the crowds beginning to scatter now as the Pope meets with these world leaders. I don't think they know that they're in for a papal drive-by, so they should stay put. Don't go anywhere.
That's
your
right.
Final thoughts on this incredible day. It was so beautiful, and the lead-up was, I think, as beautiful as the day. Meeting all of these pilgrims, they reflect so the spirit of John Paul II and John the 23rd.
Yeah, I think these past few days have just been utterly extraordinary. The weather here has cooperated in Rome. Rome is a place that's very welcoming and has a certain docility to it, a certain sweetness even to it. But I think for me, this really, 4 or 5 decades of Catholicism came together for me with the celebration of these two popes.
Yeah. Father?
Again, I recall being on Boston Common in 1979 and hearing the Pope speak, St. John Paul II speak about come follow me, and I think the great message of his canonization is continue to follow me as I serve the Church by praying for you in heaven, and follow his example. He was a heroic and courageous man who lived the faith. We need courage right now. There's no shortage of people who think they know what they need to do, but many of them are misled. We need courage to speak the truth to them and say follow Christ in his Church. Do what St. John Paul II did, lead people to Christ.
Well, that was the incredible thing this week when we were all at that dinner with L'Equilessa and we listened to what he had to say about that moment in history when they were staring down these missiles and tanks and the numbers, and they thought there's no way we can face this. And yet John Paul said, no, you can, be not afraid, but don't forget your faith. This is what's going to win the victory for you, that God is bigger than all of this.
Absolutely.
And that really is the hallmark of that life and all the lives of the saints.
Absolutely. You know, being a saint is the real goal of human life. That's what we have to follow. And the saints teach us what it means to be truly human.
Robert Royal, final word.
Yeah, and we have to keep remembering that we need new saints. So we need that courage that Father is talking about, and a courage based in reality, the truth of what things are. there are challenges just as difficult today as there were in the times of John the 23rd and John Paul II. And there are some people maybe out there listening right now who may step up and continue that legacy.
No doubt. Robert Royal, Father Jerry Murray, thank you both for being here. It's been a joy as always. Well, that concludes our live coverage of the Mass and canonizations of Saints John the 23rd and John Paul II. You can catch the primetime encore at 7 p.m. Eastern time on Sunday evening and again at 11 p.m. Eastern on Monday, April 28th. For those of you who are international viewers outside the U.S., please check EWTN.com for re-air times in your region. Be sure to watch The World Over next week. We'll have some important Rome features. And both the EWTN Facebook page and mine have been very active during these days. Check them out. There's some special pictures and exclusives there. Teresa Tomeo and others created some exclusive content you won't want to miss. Also, be sure to download the EWTN app. You can now take EWTN anywhere. Go to EWTN.com for more information. Before we go, a special thanks to dear Mother Angelica, who turned 91 last Sunday. She followed a tiny inspiration more than 30 years ago that allowed all of us to enjoy this global family reunion. We love you, Mother, and thank you. On behalf of the staff and crew of EWTN News, thank you for watching. I'm Raymond Arroyo reporting from Rome. See you next time. Ciao.